Hello and welcome to our July webinar on medical device software, looking especially at software as a medical device and the current developments in the regulatory world. My name is Yervant Chijian and I am a senior consultant here at Brownwood CKC. I bring over 20 years of experience in the regulatory and quality field, primarily working with devices which include software or that are standalone software medical devices. I'm excited to do this presentation and will also discuss some hot topics in regards to software as a medical device. For those of you who are not familiar with Brownwood CKC, we are a regulatory consultancy firm headquartered in Sydney, Australia. We specialize in regulatory, quality systems, and commercialization across all areas of therapeutics and diagnostics and have been serving local and international health science innovators for more than 20 years. The agenda for today's webinar will start with looking at some definitions for software in and as a medical device, and including the differences, regulatory updates for Europe, Australia, Canada, and US in regards to software as a medical device, the regulatory pathways for software, a brief look at applicable standards for all medical device software, some post-market regulatory considerations for software, information security considerations. We'll then look at software verification and validation, and finally, the regulatory impact of incorporating artificial intelligence, machine learning within a software device. To kick things off, it is important to understand the context of medical device software as technological advancements are made all around us, especially as the internet and mobile devices become part of our everyday lives. The internet has provided an insurgent of technologies, products, and services across many industries around the Internet of Things or IoT infrastructures and software, and healthcare being one of them. Within the IoT world, digital health has been growing exponentially to include technologies in the healthcare space for both consumer and healthcare practitioners, such as wearable technologies, health apps, and connected medical devices. Finally, within the digital space, two distinct technology groups exist: healthcare information technologies and regulated medical devices with software. Health information technology examples include electronic patient health records, clinical information systems, practice management software, telehealth, and so on. Regulated medical devices with software examples include medical imaging, surgical robots, IVD devices, communicative implants, software as a medical device, and so on. So the big question is, when does a software health product become a medical device? Well, a software health product is considered a medical device if it meets the IMDRF definition of a medical device. That is, software as a medical device, or SAMD or SAMD, is defined as software intended to be used for one or more medical purposes that perform these purposes without being part of a hardware medical device. It must have a medical purpose. Put simply, if the intended use of the standalone software includes diagnosis, or screening, prevention, monitoring, treatment, or alleviation of disease. The challenges with medical device software is that the intended use or claims may be explicit, that is, within the product labeling or instructions for use. However, they may also be implicit, that is, within the feature set, the data presentations, expected or known use in the field, and significance, criticality of the information provided. Also, software can change over time. The quick-paced development opportunities for software means that with the introduction of new features, the intended use or claims may be broadened and hence impact on the regulatory status. The regulatory or market authorization process includes classifying the software based on the risk to the patient. The information used to evaluate the classification and whether the software is a medical device should all take into consideration how the software can benefit a patient, if the software generates information that influences or supports medical care, also known as clinical decision software support, and whether the intended use is a healthcare professional or patient. Traditionally, medical device software was primarily referred to as software that was part of a host or parent device or hardware, that is, software in a medical device. With the rise of standalone software devices, a group known as software as a medical device has come about. The differences between software in a medical device and software as a medical device are listed here. Software in a medical device can be incorporated within or interfaces directly with a medical device hardware. They can be embedded firmware. They're also known as programmable electrical medical systems, referenced in IEC 601-1 standard. They may be part of a control system. There may be a desktop application that directly interfaces with a hardware device. They are usually the same class as a host or parent system or hardware. These are regular like any other medical device and usually included within the host or parent device submissions. On the other hand, software as a medical device are standalone software irrespective of the operating platform. That is, it is accepted by regulators that generic or common operating systems or platforms are not included in the scope of the software as a medical device for registration submissions. However, they need to be specified during development and the software validated on specific platforms or OS. There are also computer software with medical purpose, as mentioned in the previous slide. They can be medical mobile apps, they can be web-based apps, or run as software as a service. And they have specific classification rules or risk profiles based on significance of the information for clinical decision making. So changes in regulations are being made, such as classification and requirements specific for software and medical devices. This is important as the current regulations do not include provisions for software and software as medical devices separate to physical medical devices. Where this poses particular challenges is that the classification rules that exist for medical devices currently only consider the possible harm caused by physical interaction of a medical device with a human. As software does not have this physical interaction, the risk associated with these types of products relate more to the analysis and calculation errors and inaccuracies in diagnosis and clinical treatment recommendations. It is for this reason the current classification rules result in the classification of the software as a medical device products that do not necessarily align with the level of risk posed to the patient. So the new specific classification framework is required. And I will discuss this in more detail in a few slides. Here we have listed some examples of software that are likely to be software as a medical device and those unlikely. Likely software as medical device examples include rehab software, which provides measurements of changes in mobility and posture, desktop software to detect and track sleep disorder breathing, mobile app that analyzes patient information and physiological parameters, for example, heart rate, blood pressure, to determine a treatment plan, software which processes and analyzes physiological images, for example, apps to analyze skin lesions. On the other hand, some examples of software that are unlikely to be software as a medical device includes software used in the manufacture of medical devices and which have no therapeutic purpose. Software used to statistically evaluate clinical study results, registers, etc. Health coaches and lifestyle apps, including databases that help maintain a healthy lifestyle. And software for reimbursement, resource management, such as staff and patient visit scheduling and other non-medical purposes. As we explore what types of software is considered a medical device, one group of software products that needs to be addressed are those known as medical device data systems, or MDDS. The FDA has provided some guidance around these software products and included a definition which states, medical device data systems are hardware or software products intended to transfer, store, convert formats, and display medical device data. An MDDS does not modify the data or modify the display of the data, and it does not by itself control the functions or parameters of any other medical device. MDDS may or may not be intended for active patient monitoring. The FDA further provides definitions between non-device and device MDDS, stating that non-device MDDS are software functions that are solely intended to transfer, store, convert formats, and display medical device data or medical imaging data. Device MDDS are hardware functions that are solely intended to transfer, store, convert formats, and display medical device data or results. As of September 2019, FDA has reviewed the use and risks of these types of software and stated that all non-device MDDS are not considered devices and not subject to FDA regulatory requirements applicable to medical devices. In addition, all device MDDS are not regulated, provided that the hardware function is limited to assisting the software functions for electronic transfer, storage, conversion of formats, or display or medical device data. However, software functions that analyze or interpret medical device data, in addition to transferring, storing, converting formats, or displaying clinical laboratory tests or other device data and results, remain subject to FDA's regulatory oversight. The TGA has made some grounds in this area too. Earlier this year, the TGA released responses to a public consultation paper on scope of regulated software-based products. The aim was to seek industry feedback to clarify the boundary for software-based medical devices that are in law regulated but could potentially be exempt or excluded. The scope included MDDS, and industry was supportive of any possible changes to the regulations. We will now discuss some of the regulatory changes expected in the near future, specifically how they impact software as a medical device, starting with the EU. In Europe, the new European Medical Device Regulations 2017-745, or MDR, came into force in May 2017. It was planned for implementation on 26 May of this year. The MDR repeals the existing Directive on Medical Devices. That is the Medical Device Directive 93/42 and Active Implantable Medical Device Directive 90/385. However, due to COVID-19, this has been postponed to 26 May 2021. The MDR includes significant changes for software as a medical device by providing clear considerations of software and the potential risks. The MDR now includes clear definitions for software as a medical device, which clarifies that software which operates in its own right and has a health purpose is a medical device, whereas software intended for lifestyle and well-being purposes is not a medical device. The MDR also introduced Rule 11 to classify software as a medical device based on the IMDRF risk classifications and how the information that the software provided is used for decisions in relation to diagnosis and therapeutic purposes. Most software previously classed as Class 1 under the MDD are likely to be upclassified to Class 2A or higher. In addition, other changes include recognition that software is an active device, inclusion of requirements around software development, lifecycle, information security, mobile computing platforms, special labeling requirements, for example, hardware, IT networks, security measures, specific risk management considerations, application of UDI for software, including for software changes. Finally, in October 2019, the Medical Device Coordination Group in Europe published a guidance on qualification and classification of software for the MDR and IVDR. The guidance provided information on implementing the new rules in the MDR and IVDR for software. It provides definitions and criteria around software as a medical device and greater clarity and examples of how to apply the new rules for various types of software. Let's now look at the regulatory changes in Australia. The current TGA regulations do not include provisions for software as a medical device separately to physical medical devices. In December 2019, the therapeutic goods legislation was amended to include a number of reforms to the medical device regulations, including changes to the regulations around software as a medical device. The commencement of the new software regulations were planned for 25th of August 2020. However, due to COVID-19, the commencement has been delayed to the 25th February 2021. One of the significant changes was the introduction of new classification rules specifically for software as a medical device within Part 4 of Schedule 2 of the regulations. The impact of the new rules means that in some cases, devices may be a lower classification where a relevant healthcare professional is involved. Also, most devices will remain the same class if they provide direct diagnosis or monitoring. Finally, if devices intend to provide therapy via the provision of information, for example, a medical device intended to provide cognitive behavioral therapy, will potentially be a higher class in some cases. The new classification rules will not apply to IVD medical devices. There will also be a number of changes to the essential principles, such as essential principle 12.1 has been amended to clarify the expectations around these type of devices in regards to cybersecurity, the management of data and information, and requirements relating to development, production, and maintenance. Essential Principle 13.2 has been amended to allow information, where applicable, to be provided electronically rather than on a leaflet for medical devices that are software. And a new requirement has been introduced as Essential Principle 13B for identification of current version and build number to be made accessible by and identifiable to users of medical devices that are or that incorporate software. In regards to the regulatory changes in Canada, in December 2019, Health Canada published their guidance document on software as a medical device. Similar to the EU and Australia, Canada also adopted the IMDRF framework for software as a medical device, including the definitions of software as a medical device that we spoke about earlier, and classification based on the significance of the information provided by the software to a healthcare decision, and also on the state of healthcare situation or condition. The classifications for software as a medical device are defined in the guidance, fall within the current classification rule 10 and 12, with low risk software being classified as class 1 and higher risk as class 3. The FDA has been at the forefront in trying to address the challenges with regulating medical device software with the introduction of the 21st Century Cures Act back in 2016. In particular, the Act included a section to clarify medical software regulation, especially adding a definition of a software as a medical device in line with IMDRF. As a result, a number of changes were made to the regulations. Changes to existing guidance documents such as off-the-shelf software use, cybersecurity, and publishing of new guidance documents specifically for medical device software, such as guidance for mobile medical applications, general wellness devices, medical device data systems, artificial intelligence, machine learning, etc. One of the new initiatives that came out of the 21st Century Cures Act was the launch of the Software Pre-Certification Pilot Program. The program's goal is to help inform the development of a future regulatory model that will provide more streamlined and efficient regulatory oversight of software-based medical devices developed by manufacturers who have demonstrated a robust culture of quality and organizational excellence, and who are committed to monitoring real-world performance of their products. The focus of the program is on a total product lifecycle approach, as opposed to pre-market applications. That is, the proposed approach aims to look first at the software developer or digital health technology developer, rather than primarily at the product, which has been a traditional approach to medical device pre-market pathways. It also integrates IMDRF risk categories to determine possible levels of pre-market reviews. In 2019, the pre-cert program entered its test phase with the intent to confirm that the framework proposed in the working model provides an equivalent reasonable assurance of safety and effectiveness for software products. In the most recent update report by the FDA, they explained that the retrospective testing has been completed, looking at selected software as a medical device submissions, and that the test achieved its objectives in identifying the feasibility of the streamlined review to be sufficient to conduct a pre-market review of software as a medical device. The FDA continues to work with selected pilot participants who have volunteered for the 2019 testing of the working model, and in some cases to test pre-cert program components for the review of de novo requests or 510k submissions. We will hopefully hear more on this later this year. I just wanted to now briefly discuss a high-level overview of the regulatory pathway for software. If you have determined that you have a software as a medical device, your product will be regulated in the same way as other medical devices of the same risk class. There are basically two frameworks: the GHTF approach adopted by Australia, Europe, and Canada, and the pre-market submission approach used in the US. Firstly, for the GHTF approach, the medical device classification must first be determined, which is based on a set of classification rules. The level of regulatory intervention is based on the class applied to the device. Each jurisdiction has a set of mandatory requirements concerning medical device safety, design, labeling, clinical evidence, and so on. In Australia, these are the essential principles. In the EU, they are the general safety and performance requirements. And in Canada, they are the safety and effectiveness requirements. To meet the mandatory requirements, typically standards are applied to demonstrate compliance. Key standards typically apply to software, which cover software development, usability, information security, and so on. We will cover some of these in the following slides. All the required documentation are then compiled into a technical file for each device or family of devices. A technical file is then assessed by the relevant regulatory body for registration of the device, except for Class 1 devices which involve a self-declaration process. Finally, local representatives are appointed within each jurisdiction with varied responsibilities. The US approach is somewhat different in that the classification is based on product codes, which are contained in FDA's product code catalog for all the various device types. The classification will then determine the submission pathway, either a pre-market notification 510K, pre-market approval PMA, or de novo if a product code does not exist for the software device. The means of compliance is usually by using clinical experience, evidence, trials, and or demonstrating substantial equivalence through predication. In addition, FDA recognizes consensus standards, which may be used to demonstrate compliance for certain devices. It is required to appoint a local US agent for non-US manufacturers. Lastly, for all jurisdictions, the manufacturer is expected to establish a quality management system within the organization based on ISO 13485 or MDSAP in the GHTF countries and 21 CFR 820 or MDSAP in the US. As mentioned in the previous slide, it is expected that in most cases, the standards be used to demonstrate compliance. For software, the key standard is ISC 62304. Though the standard applies to all medical device software, including software that is contained within hardware or interacts with hardware, it also applies to software as a medical device. The philosophy of this standard is based on three principles: software engineering, risk management, quality management, or processes. The standard provides a generic life cycle process for software development. It is not prescriptive in terms of the detailed methods or exact processes to be implemented. It is a framework which is based on software best practice and fundamental software engineering principles. It focuses on lifecycle planning and defines documentation requirements. That is, it provides the processes and the expected artifacts or deliverables required based on the software safety class of the software device. The key elements of the standard are software risk management, software development planning, software requirements, detailed design, integration and testing, software configuration management, software problem resolution, and software maintenance. A common question that comes up often is if the standard is compatible with iterative development processes. Yes, it is. Though the standard seems to follow a traditional waterfall model, it does allow for iterative development, such as agile. The key is to document the processes within your QMS and development plan that identifies within which development stages the iterations occur. For example, say during detailed design and unit implementation and verification, and when design freeze occurs for integrated testing or software system testing. In an iterative model, configuration management is key in ensuring that the outputs be updated properly to maintain their consistency with each other and to maintain all dependencies. Finally, it is important to integrate ISC 62304 processes within your organization's QMS design and development processes. This will ensure that the software development is conducted according to uniform procedures and produce the required outputs. Another process standard is the ISC 62366-1 Usability Engineering Standard. Usability engineering also includes the concept of human factors design. The usability engineering process is intended to achieve reasonable usability, which in turn is intended to minimize use errors and to minimize use associated risks. The process should be applied early in the development process to address user interactions with the medical device software according to the user documentation, which include operation and maintenance of the product. The key activities are shown here, which occur during the design and development process. Firstly, during design input phase, the preliminary user interface, user experience requirements, or UI UX, must be defined. These include the application specifications, use case scenarios, intended users, etc. You are then able to identify potential hazards, which include user errors, foreseen misuse, etc. During detailed design and output phase, the UI/UX requirements are converted to engineering specifications, such as the software requirement specifications, and implemented within the software code or interface design. These also will include the risk mitigations. When designing the preliminary UI/UX, consideration should be made of the technical knowledge, experience, education, and training, where applicable, the medical and physical conditions of the intended users. Additionally, any pre-sales training and or post-market clinical follow-up should be identified. Finally, during the design VMV phase, the UI/UX design is verified along with the software VMV processes. Usability studies must then be conducted in the form of user evaluations, formative or summative studies involving study participants which represent the intended users. The output of the studies are typically contained in a usability study or evaluation report. Due to the nature of software that is quick and evolving, it is important to briefly discuss the post-market or post-product release considerations. Regulators expect that the manufacturer collect and analyze post-market data for the life of the device. Due to the flexible nature of software, it is possible to actually incorporate mechanisms within the software to collect the data for regular monitoring and review. There are four key post-market activities to focus on. Issue management, covering processes for adverse event monitoring, complaints and recalls processing, problem resolution processing. Information security or cybersecurity, covering processes for monitoring of vulnerabilities and threats, monitoring of third-party software, patching and updates. Software maintenance, applying standard software processes for managing user requirement changes and enhancements, managing third-party software changes, managing configuration changes, for example, platform or OS changes. Quality assurance, building into the software or defining processes to gather customer feedback, gather performance metrics, gather quality metrics such as quality of input or process data, amongst other things. During each of these processes, the risk and the clinical and regulatory impact should be assessed for any impact on the regulatory status of the software to ensure that any issues, changes, and use of the software will continue to operate as intended, and that no new hazards arise that may directly or indirectly harm the patient or change the classification status. These processes become even more critical when you add the requirements for artificial intelligence and machine learning algorithm changes, which we will discuss shortly. Information security considerations and management is essential for any connected technology, and medical device software is not excluded from these considerations. It is likely that all software as a medical device these days are running on platforms that are connected online. Therefore, a strong emphasis must be placed on information security. The medical device regulators too have identified the seriousness of information security and expect requirements to be included during the design input phases of product development to address these. IEC 62304 also includes requirements for security, specifically for third-party software items used within the software as a medical device. The impact of the third-party software on security must be assessed during the development process. Regulators have been making recent updates in regards to cybersecurity, such as the EU MDR now includes specific requirements for cybersecurity in the general safety and performance requirements. The FDA has published guidance documents on cybersecurity for a long time, and the most recent update in the pre-market submission requirements guidance on cybersecurity published October 2018. During July 2019, the TGA published a cybersecurity guidance to help device manufacturers or developers understand the expectations of TGA on how to address cybersecurity. And during March 2020, the IMDRF published N60 guidance document on principles and practices for medical device cybersecurity. There are also industry standards that may be applied to the manufacturer's processes, such as ISO 27000 series or IEC 8001, especially if the manufacturer has control over the infrastructure. Finally, note the privacy legislations or acts may apply to your software if the software as a medical device collects personal data or individuals' health information. These include, among others, the US HIPAA Act. Any healthcare provider who transmits health information in electronic form must comply. the EU General Data Protection Regulations, and the Australian Privacy Act 1988. Another important consideration and several points I would like to mention is around software verification and validation. We know that software as a medical device can be deployed on various operating platforms, such as desktop PC apps, mobile apps, web apps, software as a service. And also the regulatory oversight and requirements for software as a medical device apply to the software itself and not the platform. Therefore, the manufacturer must ensure that the specifications of the platform is specified during product development and that the software as a medical device is validated on the targeted platform or equivalent prior to release. Also, the labeling should reflect the validation envelope to which the product was tested. The results from validation testing or studies must confirm the intended use and claims as stated in the labeling, with the outcomes very clearly discussed in labeling. The VMV must follow the manufacturer's QMS design processes and IEC 63.04. This diagram illustrates a typical example of the VMV processes for software as a medical device and the relationship of those processes to ISO 13485 and FDA 21 CFR 820 design control QMS processes. Firstly, design verification involves unit testing, integration testing, and can be conducted in an iterative process. Once all the software requirements have been implemented and verified, a design freeze is approved, allowing a release candidate ready for design validation during the design transfer phase. The design validation may then involve user acceptance testing, usability validation, and clinical validation. The final software is approved for release as a stable build to the corresponding production platform. Typically, during software development, various environments are used for testing. An important point here is to ensure that the environment for design validation is the same as the production platform or an equivalent simulator platform is utilized. Another hot topic is the emergence of artificial intelligence or machine learning technologies within software as a medical devices. It has been challenging for regulators to apply existing or traditional regulatory processes to deal with the adaptive nature of AI and machine learning based software. AI and machine learning based software includes algorithms, models, or data that may vary during its use in the field, which would have previously been considered significant changes and would have required pre-market review and submissions. Outside the US, not much headway has been made in this field by regulators. In April 2019, the FDA published a discussion paper titled Proposed Regulatory Framework for Modifications to Artificial Intelligence Machine Learning-Based Software as a Medical Device. In the new proposed framework, the FDA introduces a predetermined change control plan to be included in pre-market submissions for software as a medical devices. The plan includes approved pre-specifications and algorithm change protocols. These define the envelope or boundaries of the AI machine learning algorithms. Pre-market review is required only for significant changes outside the defined envelope of the pre-specifications and algorithm change protocol. Increased transparency to users and FDA using post-market real-world performance reporting for maintaining continued assurance of safety and effectiveness is expected. The framework also includes a strong emphasis on a culture of quality and organizational excellence, adopting good machine learning practices. Although this new plan is FDA-focused, it is believed, but not yet documented, that IMDRF will follow suit. This diagram illustrates FDA's new framework. As the AI model is developed and evolves through training and tuning, there are four key elements the FDA proposes as part of the pre-market submissions and for ongoing review and monitoring. At one, the organization needs to set a clear expectation of the quality systems and good machine learning practices. At two, conduct pre-market review for those softwares as a medical device that require pre-market submissions to demonstrate reasonable assurance of safety and effectiveness and establish clear expectations for manufacturers of AI machine learning based software to continually manage patient risks throughout the lifecycle. At three, expect manufacturers to monitor AI machine learning device and incorporate a risk management approach and other approaches for assessing software changes to the device in development, validation, and execution of the algorithm changes, including the software pre-specifications and the algorithm change protocol. And at four, enable increased transparency to users and FDA using post-market real-world performance reporting for maintaining continued assurance of safety and effectiveness. To finish off this webinar, here are the key takeaways and conclusions I would like to share. Firstly, there is a difference in definition in how regulators view software as a medical device and software in a medical device. In general, MDDS do not fall into the same medical device classifications as software as a medical device and software in a medical device. There are significant changes for software as a medical device for most regulatory agencies upcoming, so be prepared. Development of software, including its documentation, should be aligned with ISC 62304. Manufacturers cannot forget usability, human factors, and ISC 62366 must be applied to your software. Software VMV must carefully address the design and testing envelope, with the outcomes clearly discussed in labeling. Finally, AI machine learning software and its uniqueness is now being considered by regulators, but no clear guidance has been universally accepted. Thank you to those of you who have sent in questions. I have covered some throughout my presentation today. However, to complete today's webinar, and with the limited time, I wanted to respond to one of the questions sent in. The question was, how to differentiate middleware that is outside the definition of a medical device from a software as a medical device? For example, software developed for a hospital network that is intended to collect patient data from medical devices that will be used for interpretation and clinical decision making. What guidance exists that talks specifically to this? This is a good question. I covered some of this in the slide discussing medical device data systems. Firstly, it is important to determine if the middleware does fit in the definition of an MDDS. That is, it only transfers, stores, converts, formats, or displays medical device data or medical imaging data. If the middleware functions outside this definition, then it may be considered a software as a medical device. For example, if the middleware performs some calculation, interpretation, or may suggest or exclude certain medical conditions, then it is what is called decision support software and likely to be considered a medical device. As mentioned, in the EU, the Medical Device Coordination Group published the guidance document MDCG 2019-11 in October 2019, titled Guidance on Qualification and Classification of Software in the MDR and IVDR. It provides very good guidelines and descriptions for various software used in healthcare systems. It also provides examples of software that may or may not be defined as a medical device. The FDA also published some time ago a guidance addressing MDDS and the regulatory pathway for such technologies. Up until September 2019, MDDS software were classified as Class 1 devices under FDA's classification system. In the most recent September 2019 guidance document, FDA stated that it does not intend to enforce compliance with the regulatory controls that apply to MDDS, medical image storage devices, and medical image communication devices, due to the low risk they pose to patients and the importance they play in advancing digital health. This guidance also provides definitions and examples of various software used in healthcare systems. I hope this answered your question. We have now concluded the webinar. There are many ways to keep in touch with Brownwood CKC. Please do visit our website, where you will find additional information on medical device software previously published in our blog and webinar pages. Alternatively, please do get in touch if you have any additional questions or if we can be of further assistance. Thank you for listening today. I hope you found this presentation informative.